السلام على الحسين وعلى علي بن الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى أصحاب الحسين. Amani ya Mwenyezi Mungu imfikie Hussein na Ali mwana wa Hussein na wana wa Hussein na masahaba wa Hussein.
Welcome back to our program with Sheikh Abdul Jalil from Washington and myself Naiman Anji. Please feel free to send your comments or questions on the number on the screen. Today, in fact, we're going to continue with our lessons from Karbala, which we had started yesterday. And our lesson for today will be forgiveness. And let me introduce you, Sheikh. Thank you for coming back. You can actually enlighten us more on this.
Thank you. In the name of Allah, the most merciful, the most kind, in continuation of our topic for today about forgiveness and how can we learn forgiveness from these oceans of Imam Hussein, of his tragedy. First of all, we have to understand that forgiveness is something that Islam has emphasized so much. And this forgiveness starts from Allah himself. That Allah call himself, he is all forgiven, which in Quran and Arabic is called Al-Afu or Al-Ghafur, all forgiven. That we as his servant, when we wrong him and we call upon him, immediately he forgives. There is a story mentioned that Prophet Musa, which is Moses, one time he was having a dialogue with Allah, because you know Moses, one of his titles is called Kalimullah, the one who speaks to Allah directly without angel in between. So one day he was talking to Allah. He said, Ya Rab, what do you say to your servant who is obedient and he calls upon you? Then Allah said, I say to that servant, Labbaik. Which is, yes, here I am. What do you need? Then he says, I have another question. What do you say to your servant who is in the middle of your obedience, the state of ruku or sujood, and then he calls upon you? Then Allah said, I will say, labbaik. Oh, here I am, my servant. Then he said, my third question, what do you say to your servant who is in the middle of sin, but then he remembers you and he calls upon you? What do you do? Then now the answer changed. See, the first one is labbaik. The second one, labbaik. The third one, Allah said to Moses, I will say labbaik, labbaik, labbaik three times. Then Moses asked, Ya Allah, why three times for the sinner and one time for the obedient servant? He said, because this servant who is obedient, he already know me and he is in my obedience. But this one, he doesn't know me. That's one distance. Then he is committing sin. That's another distance. So he is far away. So to bring him closer, I'll answer three times so that he doesn't become hopeless for my mercy. That is what a person who is disobedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is how God is to us, forgiving and always welcoming. Now there's another story also. It is mentioned that there was an idol worshiper who sat in his room one night and he was calling the idol. An idol in Arabic is called Sanam. Sanam means idol. So he has his idol in front of him and he was calling, Ya Sanam, Ya Sanam, like we do tasbih. Yeah. Ya Sanam, Ya Sanam, Ya Sanam, Ya Sanam. Then he got tired. He started falling asleep. So during that process, mistakenly, he said, Ya Samad. Instead of Ya Sanam, he said Samad. And Samad is the name of Allah. So by that mistake, when he said, Ya Samad, then Allah responded in the heavens, Labbayka, Labbayka, Labbayka Ya Abdi Sal Tu'ta. Which means, yes, 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 my servant, ask and you will be given. The angels, they were thought, Ya Allah, this man, he didn't mean to call you.
Yes.
He meant to call his idol, and that's what he was doing.
Yes.
And then you suddenly answering him by mistake. Then the answer came from Allah. He said, yes, I know. He was calling the idol all night, and the idol didn't respond. And by mistake, he calls me. If I don't respond, then what's the difference between me and idol? I respond to him to tell my servant that there is difference between me and your idol. The idol doesn't respond and I do respond to you. That is Allah with an idol worshiper. That is, doors are always open for him, for forgiveness. That all we need to do is to call upon Allah. No matter what we do in our life of sins, always keep that hope. Now let me give you one story from the Quran. About always, we should keep in mind that Allah is always there for us. You know, one of the prophets is called Prophet Yunus, alayhi salam. Yunus was born and raised in Iraq, in a city called Nineveh. And he was sent to a group of people, which Quran says, mi'at alf, like 100,000 people in that city of Nineveh. This Yunus, alayhi salam, after he called his people for several months, years, and they were not responding the way he was expecting them, then he thought that God is now about to punish them. So what happened? He decided to leave. Now, as he left, because he was thinking God will send the punishment on the people, and he doesn't want to be part of it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, okay, you left, you go ahead, let's see what's going to happen. As he left the city, and he has to catch a ferry or a boat to cross and leave that city to another city. The story is known about what happened, and then in the boat started shaking and about to capsize. They threw a lot of belongings of people to keep the boat stable. Didn't work. Then it came to the point where the captain of the boat decided that they have to throw one person in the sea. Now, who's going to be let to be thrown? You want to throw my clothes? Yes, go ahead. Throw me? No. Who is willing?
Yeah.
Now, then they came up with the idea that they have to do a ballot, which is writing everybody's name, putting in the box, and take one name. Whosoever name comes out, he's be the one to be thrown in the sea. Okay? Then come to find, when they took the name, the first name was Prophet Yunus. You will think he will be the last one, right? Because he's a prophet of Allah. He should be saved. But no, that's not how Allah works. His name came up. They say, Prophet Yunus, so we're going to throw you. The first Prophet Yunus said, come on, guys. What are you thinking? This is not fair. So why my name comes? They said, okay, we're going to do it one more time. They didn't want the second time. And come to find, his name came up. They said, come on, there is something wrong with this ballot. How my name is coming all the time? He said, let's try the last time. If my name comes up, then I'll surrender. They put the names together. The name came up, and the name was that they came up was the name of Prophet Yunus. After the third time, now he surrendered. He said, okay, now. Prophet Yunus was thrown in the river. By the time they threw him in the river, Allah already ordered a whale opening his mouth, waiting for Yunus to be swallowed. Yunus alayhi salam was swallowed by that whale. When he was swallowed by the whale, and Quran says, the whale took Prophet Yunus deep and deeper and deeper of that ocean. Which Quran says, Prophet Yunus ended up being in three deep darkness. Darkness number one, in the whale's stomach. It's a dark. That's one. Number two, the darkness of the ocean, because the ocean, as you go deep, is dark. That's two. Number three, the darkness of the night, because it's happening at night. So he was in all of this. Then Allah said in the Quran, He said, my decision about Yunus is for him to stay there till the day of Qiyamah. He is not supposed to come out. That was the decision of Allah. But Prophet Yunus alayhi salam, he knew that Allah is always forgiving. So what happened? Quran says, then he called upon Allah. Fanada fi dhulumat. He called upon Allah in those darkness that he was. Allah ilaha illa ant subhanaka inni kuntu min al-zalimin. Then Allah says, fastajabna lahu. When he called upon Allah, Allah said, we then respond to his call. You know, it's like, you know, we have these fire services, right? God forbid, if somebody's house is catching fire, all you need to do is to call. Yeah. When you call, they come, right? So Allah said the same thing with Sulaiman and Yunus. He says, you Prophet Yunus called. And what happened? We went to help him, to rescue him, right? Now, look at the amazing about God's forgiveness. He was doing something God did not authorize him to do. And he asked God to forgive him. God said, then we authorize that whale two things. Number one, whatever the whale ate should be digestive. That's fine. But the whale is not allowed to digest the body of Prophet Yunus. That's one. Number two, then Allah ordered the whale also to make sure that he brings Prophet Yunus at the shore and let him out safe and sound. And that's what happened. Right? Now, when Sulaiman, when Prophet Yunus was thrown out, he was very tired. It was very hot. But look at the mercy of Allah and how God forgives. God said, because we forgave him, we made a tree to grow right there so that it gives him a shade while he's laying down and resting. The Prophet Yunus alayhi salam. But the bottom line is, Allah forgave him immediately, instantly, when he called upon Allah. That is the lesson we learn from the Quran in terms of forgiveness. Now, this is from God. Now you come to the Prophet, the chain is the same. The Prophet was all forgiven. And the forgiveness of the Prophet is that sometimes we forgive our loved ones. Oh, it's my son. You know, we have, it's my blood, so I cannot help it. I have to, that's one thing, right? He is my mom, he's my dad, he's my son. This is what we, but you see, the Prophet has taken this to the next level, where he forgave his enemies. His enemies. Like when you look when the Prophet was in Mecca, the same people of Mecca, they killed the companions of the Prophet. They killed Yasir. They killed Sumayya in Mecca. And for no reason except because they were Muslims. Yeah. The same people forced the Prophet and sent his companions to Abyssinia. The same companions forced the Prophet to go to Medina. But guess what? When the Prophet went to Medina and the Battle of Badr took place, and no, before the battle, when the Prophet came and conquered Mecca and captured those leaders from Mecca, then the Prophet asked them, what do you think I'm going to do to you? They said, you are generous, son of generous. Then the Prophet says, you're all forgiven. Go away. All of them. Not one person was hurt by the Prophet. And these were his enemies. These are the people who hurt him. But this is how he was so forgiven to them. And that is one of the lessons of Karbala.
MashaAllah. Okay, we'll take a short commercial break and return in a few minutes. Thank you.
They say the most heartbreaking line of the Maqtal about Abdul Abbas Aislam is where it says that his hands were cut, but he kept on moving. The arrow pierced his eye, he kept on moving. It was only when the arrow pierced the canteen where the water was kept, it says, فَوَقَفَ Abbas مُتَحِيَّرَ. What that means is Abbas stood confused. Why is he confused? Because he doesn't know if he should go back to the river and get the water or if he should go towards the tents without any water. He's confused. And I swear to God, How much we hear about Abdul Abbas, I have never heard the line mutahayyara. He's confused in the entirety of his life. And one wonders what the zeal of Abbas went through watching those daughters of Hussein dying from thirst, dying. As if they couldn't speak anymore, they would gesture with their hands for water. As if their skin had turned pale and their pupils had rolled back into their eyes from that thirst. I swear to God, none of us will ever understand what 3 days of thirst can do to you, especially to young girls, young daughters of Abu Abdullah Hussein alayhi salam. I tell him, Abu Fadl, they are thirsty. That water, throw it away. He kneels and watches them. They say that Abu Abbas would only kneel when he sits down. Why? So if someone needed anything, he would spring right up. He kneels and watches them. Anger fights patience in him. Each child has a problem because the thirst is mighty. One child's skin has turned white, tongue as dry as desert night. One child cries from her fright, saying, Abu Fadl, I'm thirsty. One child's skin has turned white. One tongue is as dry as desert night. And one child cries out from her fright, Abu Fadl, I'm thirsty. One hand like a fist clenches. One hand for his sword reaches. And from one knee the moon rises, crying, I shall make them pay. I walk to him, my head is bowed. There is nothing of which I'm proud. On my grief I face a shroud, and I say, Hussein, they might die. He replies, brother, if you go, go with you shall my shadow. The girls are thirsty, I know, but who will hold my flag high? You remind me of Haydar, and the river is your Khaybar. I'll let you go get the water, but do not say goodbye to me. To the river he sets course. A lion riding a horse. What is death? Their thirst is worse. No enemy dare come near. I wade in the blood that I shed. I wade in the blood that I shed. My white feathers, they turn blood red. By angels my horse is led. I am the man without fear. From the daughters of Zahra, you have withheld the water. In tears I saw their father, and you will pay for every tear. I have reached the riverbank. I have reached the riverbank, and I think of when they last drank. Now their pupils have all sank into the whites of their eyes. I have never admitted this, but my tongue burns in dryness. Should I remain waterless when water in front of me lies? In my two hands the water flows. In my two hands the water flows, and to my lips it comes close, but I remember their sorrows, and from my hand the water flies. I cry, O self, don't you dare, when their thirst is their despair. They gasp for water like it's air. Don't you let it touch your tongue. The water, I make it drown. The water, I make it drown. And I scare it with my frown, and I strangle my thirst down. Make me thirsty, shall no one. My hands fill up the canteen. To return towards them, I am keen. The river cannot bear this scene, and it cries out, where have you gone? Toward the tents I would ride, and their thirst still hurts me inside. But behind the tree they would hide, and they'd cut off my right hand. Then my left hand I can't find. Then my left hand I can't find. And then an arrow pierces my mind. Blood from my head, it makes me blind. And then I fall towards the sand. I look out toward the tents. I look out toward the tents, and I hear as all those girls lament. My brother, my heart confronts, and my goodbyes to him I send. My goodbyes to him I send.
Welcome back to our program, Lessons from Karbala, with Sheikh Abdul Jalil and myself, Naima Nanji. Today we are covering the topic of forgiveness, and let's continue with the same topic, yeah?
Yes, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. As we talk about the lessons of forgiveness, and we talk about how God forgives us as a human being, and how the Prophet, who is the representative of Allah among us, how he also forgives. Now let me take you to, because I want to give you the series of forgiveness from those leaders and representative of Islam. And we give for the Prophet, now I'm going to give you one for Imam Ali. Imam Ali also is the next person after the Prophet. He also has given us so much lessons on forgiveness. One lesson that we can learn from Imam Ali, and also, because I'm taking this to another level, that sometimes we forgive each other because either we're blood related, or maybe we're friends, we know each other, we have been there for each other for a while, then something comes up, yes, let's let it go. But these are examples of people who are enemies, but you still find a place in your heart to forgive them. And that is higher position of forgiveness. So Imam Ali alayhi salam, in the Battle of Siffin, which took place between him and Muawiyah, part of the process, Muawiyah was the one taking in charge of the water. And what happened was, these people, they refused to allow Imam Ali to use water, to either drink or make wudu from that water. They said no. But after that, when the time of Salat came, then Imam Ali alayhi salam, he wanted to pray. He said, Allah, let's use the water, make wudu. They said, no, we're not going to let you. Then Imam Ali alayhi salam said, okay, we're going to continue fighting, and then we're going to take the control of the water and then see what happens, which he did. Now, when Imam Ali was able to clear the enemies at the river, one of the companions says, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, let's deny them water the way they did it to us. Right? Imam Ali says, no. He said, why should we do that? He said, that's what they did to us. And mind you, in Islam, there is a verse in the Quran that you are allowed, in Islamic law, to do to other people what exactly they have done to you. As long as you're not doing more or more than that. Less is okay. Or at least at the same level. Now, if you look at that verse, Imam Ali could have said, okay, I'm not going to give you. That's his right Islamically. Right? But Imam Ali said to his companion, no. He said, why? And Imam Ali says, this is a means of a weak person, a coward, that he wants to use a water to defeat his enemy. He said, I'm not doing that. We will forgive them for whatever they did, and we'll keep the water between us. If they win, so be it. If we win, so be it. But I'm not going to hold them responsible for not giving us water. So let them use the water to drink. Let them use the water to make wudu and pray. Yeah. See the act of forgiveness. This is from Imam Ali. Now, let's go to another Imam, Imam Hassan alayhi salam, which is more practical in our life today. Yes. Imam Hassan alayhi salam, he was one day, he just walked out of the masjid from nowhere. A man walked to him, and he's called Ashami. And he said to Imam Hassan, you are a bad person. You are greedy man. You are not. He started just pouring hate, disrespect, insult, cursing on Imam Hassan alayhi salam. And Imam Hassan didn't say a word. He was listening to this man. As soon as the man said what he said, then Imam said to him, maybe you are a stranger in this city. And if you are, and you need a shelter, he said, I have shelter for you. If you need food, I have food for you. If you need clothes, he said, I'm going to clothe you. If you need money, I'm going to give you money. If you need. The Shami was absolutely shocked, because he was not expecting that. Because normally when somebody said mean to you, they expect you to be mean to them. Yeah. That's what they expect. Yeah. So he got completely opposite what he was expecting. When those words came from Imam Hassan alayhi salam, he found himself no choice but to fall on the feet of Imam Hassan, begging and asking for forgiveness.
Yeah.
But here, Imam Hassan alayhi salam, one word he said to him, He said, I forgive you and may God forgive you. I'm not holding any grudge against you. That is Imam Hassan alayhi salam. Now, you come to the Quran, Prophet Yusuf alayhi salam, you know what he went through with his siblings.
Yes.
His own brothers.
Yes.
Which is an amazing, amazing story in the Quran. Right? And we have it in Bible. We have it in the Quran. How Prophet Yusuf was so hurt by his own brother. Because, you know, Prophet Yusuf, by the way, his story is the only story in the Quran which was mentioned from the beginning till end in one chapter. Every prophet, they have their stories in different places, short here, another one here. But Prophet Yusuf is the only prophet where God started his story from his childhood till his death. And all in one surah, right? So this Prophet Yusuf, his story, how he went through, his brothers took him away from his father, threw him in the well.
Yes.
The caravan came, took him out. They sold him as a slave. And he became a maid to the king and all of that. Later on, things changed. He became the king of Egypt. Now his brothers, they found out. The Yusuf, our brother that we thought he's dead, he's still alive. And not only is he alive, he is the king now. Which is something that they never ever thought. Right? Now, when they found that Yusuf is still alive and he's the king, they went to him. And they said, and Quran quote that what they said, they say, oh Yusuf, forgive us for what we have done to you, what we put you through. The amazing part is what Yusuf said to his brothers. And Quran quote says, قَالَ لَا تَثْرِيبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الْيَوْمِ يَكْفِرُ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ. He says, don't even mention what you did. God will forgive you. Look at the power of a man who was put, because there is one dua in Mafatil Jinan, which we read about Prophet Yusuf, which his brothers put him to, and where he became a slave, which is very low. And Allah walked him through to make him the highest one. Who does that other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? But because he has a heart of forgiving, Allah showed him the mercy that when you forgive, I take care of you.
Yeah.
That is from Yusuf alayhi salam. Now, coming back to Imam Hussein alayhi salam, which is our lessons from the Karbala, we learn that Imam Hussein is the same. That with some of his companions, one of them was Hur. Hur was an enemy to begin with. As a matter of fact, he was the one who made Imam Hussein to come to Karbala. He was the one who was monitoring the movement of Imam Hussein.
Yes.
He was the one who did not let Imam Hussein to go back to Medina or go to Kufa. Right? But this man did what he did, and then the last moment,
yes,
he comes to Imam Hussein and he says, I want your forgiveness. You know, really imagine if any one of us to be in that position.
Yeah.
A person who is the cause, yes, of you going to lose your life. You're going to lose your brothers. You're going to lose your own children. You're going to lose your companions. And he brought you to that place for that to happen. And then he turned and said, please forgive me. What kind of heart would it take for someone to say, I forgive you?
Yeah.
It takes a lot. And Imam Hussein, this horror comes and says to him, please, Hussein, I know I wrong you. I know I caused all of these problems for you. But I didn't know that that was the mission of these people. And now I came to know. Would you please find a place in your heart to forgive me.
Yeah.
And now put us in the same shoe, right? When my brother takes my money, but not my... Or he takes my shoes without my permission. What do I say? I say, guess what? I will never, ever forgive you till the day of judgment.
Oh, my God.
That's us. Yeah. Right? Simplest thing. And we don't even forgive each other.
Yes.
And look at the lesson from Imam Hussein, that he knows that he's going to be killed. because of what this man did. And yet he says, I forgive you. In that simplicity, in that simple words, he said, I forgive you. And may Allah forgive you. You know, this is a lesson that we learn from Karbala. And this is a man who was not a friend. He wasn't relative. He was an enemy. But he realized his mistake. And then he comes to us. It comes to him and has forgiveness. Now, the message I want to say in this, you know, we have to understand something. That holding grudge in your heart is never good.
Yes.
Not by the religion, even your health-wise.
Yes.
You know, a research was made. And they made a research that if you have a half of glass of water in your hand, all right, when you hold it, the first time, it's light. It doesn't carry anything, right? Now, the same glass, if you hold it for 1 hour, you see your hand starts coming heavy,
yeah.
Right? The same glass, you hold it for 1 day, you see your hands becomes very heavy. Yeah. And at some point, you cannot even carry it, right? This is exactly the same thing with holding grudge in the side. The first time you hold grudge, you might not feel that, oh, it's nothing, but, you know, I'm just worried. He's about, I'm not forgiving him. But as you continue to hold it, it has an impact on your life, on your body. So if you don't want, for any reason, forget about God or other people, for your health reason, it's better for you to let it go. Your health-wise, it's good for you. People who let things go, people who forgive others, they live longer life. They live happy life than the people who hold grudges. Because
yes.
It has its own impact on your life, on your body, as time goes on. Right? So if you don't even think about religion-wise, think about your own health.
Yes.
That is for my own good that I need to let it go. Right? And another thing also to learn is that, you know, we have to understand that this life is a way of, something that if somebody wrong you today, you will never know what you're going to do them tomorrow or to do to somebody else. Right? I might wrong you today or you might wrong me today. And I said, I'm not going to forgive. Right? But tomorrow you might wrong someone worse than what somebody have done to you. But do you expect them to forgive you or you don't? If you do expect them, then why don't you forgive others? Right? So the same thing that Islam says, Allah tells us that if you want me to forgive you, learn to forgive my servants too. The way you want my mercy, have mercy upon my servant. Then I have mercy on you. So it's very important we always have this heart of forgiving others. Right? Because life is very short. To be holding grudges, to be keeping hurt in our heart for one another. I'm not going to forgive. I'm holding you against this. I'm holding this in my heart because it's not worth it. At the end of the day, sometimes things happen in the family that it's not even worth even keeping in your heart. But sometimes we keep it and we hold it in our heart and it bothers us and it impacts our life, our health, our life. And it's not even worth it. Right? And this kind of holding grudge can shorten your life. And it's not worth it. Especially people you have family, children, who need you to live long, who need your service, and you take certain things that is not that important and keep in your heart to the long run, and then your children lose you, they become orphans, or you become sick, this stroke and all of these diseases that come, it can come from the stress.
Yeah.
Right? So it's not worth it. So looking at it health-wise, looking at it religious-wise, it's your own good to always forgive. Right, there is one narration from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, "Man la yarham, la yurham." He who doesn't forgive others should not expect my forgiveness. You know, there is one story about one scholar who was very, very knowledgeable. And he had a lot of students who came from various places to learn from him. But one problem of this scholar is that he hold grudges. He doesn't forgive. He always angry at his student when somebody does something. So one day, one of his students was sick. and very sick. And the sickness goes to the point where that student is about to die. And he writes in his will that when I die, I don't want the teacher to lead my prayer. And he mentioned one of the students. And he told that student that when I pass on, I want you to lead my prayer, not the teacher. And the student said, what are you talking about? I'm a student like you. He's our scholar. Everybody followed him. How can I lead the prayer when he is there? So the student who was sick, he wrote, he said, okay, I'm going to write in my will. And all you need to do is to read it at my janaza. That's all I want. He said, okay. So he wrote, when he passed on, the day came, they want to do the janaza. The scholar came. Everybody was gathered. So the student said, the deceased has written a will, and he wants to be read public. So what is it? So they open it, and the student start reading. He wrote in it that, I want so-so-and-so student to lead my janaza and not my teacher. And my reason is, Salat al-Janaza is asking Allah to forgive the deceased. And I came to know my teacher does not forgive easily. How can he ask God to forgive me? Wow. So I want somebody who forgives to ask for forgiveness. And the teacher cried so bad that he felt that is something he fell short in life. And so it's very important to always learn to forgive if we want God's forgiveness. And that's what we learned from the Karbala's lesson as well.
Thank you so much, Sheikh, for joining us today. And inshallah, we will continue with these lessons from Karbala tomorrow again. Right. Thank you.
As-salamu ala al-Husayn wa ala Ali ibn al-Husayn وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى أصحاب الحسين أماني يا منيزي مونغو إنفكي حسين نعلي موانا وحسين نوانا وحسين نما صحابة وحسين.